It's a crime what they put on the screen. I can hardly believe what I've seen. Do they think we're a lot of children? It would bore any four-year-old. What drivel, what nonsense, what escapist technicolored twaddle.
Hello, Claire Barnett-Jones.
Hello.
Thank you so much for agreeing to do a keynote chat with me. Having been a part of the collective music team for a few songs, I know that the members are going to be absolutely thrilled to see you again. So they'll be very excited. I know that they've been supporting you on your journey when they've been able to. So we'll talk about that later. But firstly, I would like to ask, how did you discover singing?
So I discovered singing through, well, I always sang when I was younger. I kind of discovered proper singing with a bit of technique through barbershop and through the Somerset Hills Chorus, who are now called Sensational, in based in Taunton in Somerset. And I kind of turned up and as a precocious 9-year-old, 8-year-old, and heard them singing Over the Rainbow, and I kind of knocked on the door and said, I know that song, can I come and sing that with you? And then it kind of led on to me singing with them for 10 years before leaving for university. But that kind of gave me so many different opportunities within leadership roles with the Labs Youth Chorus at the time, the Ladies Association of British Barbershop Singers, and also with Sweet Adlines, and just amazing, amazing education through those channels. And then, yeah, that led me on to having some singing lessons when I was 17, and really enjoyed that. But it was more of an enjoyable thing. It wasn't kind of, I need to sing and go to university and become an opera singer. It was kind of fell that way, but it was a bit different from different paths, other paths.
Yes, the barbershop family is just amazing, isn't it? As soon as you either are embroiled into it and it becomes life or not. And I think most people just get hooked from the moment they're involved, don't they?
Completely, completely. If they don't, they haven't found the right place.
No soul. They have no soul.
Exactly.
Oh, bless. So what was it when was it that you decided, what happened to make you go, right, that's it, this is what I want to do for a career?
I don't think I even had that at music college, really. It was, I just enjoy doing it. I kind of took every opportunity. But I think it was getting into postgrad music college in London, where I went to the Royal Academy of Music, where I kind of thought I must be good enough to get into there. So how can this path happen? And growing up with not much kind of classical music around from the background that I came from, I didn't go to operas, I didn't really go to many concerts. I didn't think, oh, this is actually a career path, until I really went to London and thought, oh, people are making a living doing this and enjoying it and performing and having a great time. And that's where really kind of going to the academy, going on to the opera course and seeing that people were interested, and then getting my real kind of big first contract was at the Buxton Festival in Derbyshire, and being in the chorus there with lots of really interesting people. And yeah, it's a kind of progression. And I didn't quite also still think at that point that my career would go kind of more international. I just thought, you know, I'll be in a chorus and really enjoy singing. My self-belief has definitely grown over time, but it wasn't always there. But I, yeah, really enjoyed singing and thought this could be the thing for me to do.
Excellent. Well, I'm glad you did, because we enjoy listening. So you say that you weren't the family that you grew up with. You didn't have a heavy influence with opera or classical music. So what did you grow up listening to?
I listened to a lot of jazz. That was what I loved listening to. And I would put that on And I played instruments. So I played the saxophone and I played the viola. And I kind of did some national children's orchestras and youth orchestras. But again, they were kind of pushed towards me rather than me seeking them out. My dad loves listening to music. He would put stuff on all the time. And with my sister would always listen to Classic FM to go to sleep, which I, at the time, I found that quite weird because I wouldn't put that on to go to sleep. But she still does really enjoy listening to that. So I don't know. I think just anything with a beat really spoke to me. But then discovering classical singing made me then listen to kind of the symphonies and opera scores, and then I went into kind of listening to more stuff. And I do listen to a lot more symphonic large works with lots of brass and loud bits, as well as beautiful string melodies and things. But really my kind of listening is really with jazz, or with anything around the jazz world
for me. Okay, so when you started doing your opera, because I know that you've been, I don't think, I don't know if you're registered anymore, but a singing judge for Labs. So how did you manage to switch from barbershop to opera? And how did you sort of switch back and kind of go into different voices?
Yeah, there was a point where I could do both. And singing, I ended up in the youth chorus for Labs singing bass. And I think because that was so different from the singing that I did classically, meant that I could still sing in choruses and after the afterglows. And but there was a point, I think, I remember a bass singer who will remain nameless said to me, "Oh, you're so loud now." And I was like,
"Oh, did she have red hair by any chance?"
Pardon?
Did she have red hair by any chance? Yeah.
Okay. So yeah, it kind of got to a point where I thought, I don't think I can sing it to a point anymore, but I still love judging and I still love coaching. I still love coaching, especially. I'm not a registered judge anymore, but I still love listening to barbershop, and anything that comes up on my Facebook feed, I always click on it and listen to conventions and bits and pieces. It's still there with me all the time.
I don't think it ever goes, does it? It's part of your soul.
Perhaps one day I will be in a quartet and be able to get a gold medal. That was always my kind of plan, but maybe one day.
maybe when you're done with the professional side.
Yeah.
You wouldn't want to get off this roundabout though, would you?
Not yet.
No, not yet. Absolutely not. So COVID.
Yeah.
How did that affect you? And how's it affected the wider singing community that you're involved in?
So when I was in France in January 2020, COVID was kind of being thrown about as a word, and we all kind of thought, oh, it won't reach the UK or it won't reach Europe, but obviously it did. And then for the next few months, we were still doing productions and people started getting sick. And we were like, I wonder whether there was that in the air then. But when things finally shut down in March, I think it was 16th of March was when the theatres were closed. And I was in a production at English National Opera, and we did a rehearsal that morning, and we were all saying we thought this might be the last day or the last couple of days we won't get to stage. And that evening it was, you know, all theatres have to close. And I mean, yeah, overnight my whole work for at least the next kind of 3 months was cancelled. And that was, you know, the whole year's worth of work basically to that point. And as a young singer, my career had just started to kind of have enough work that you felt like this could be a career and I could fully support myself with singing instead of kind of adding to that with teaching or any other kind of jobs. And yeah, and overnight it kind of went. And as soon as things kind of, we thought this was going to be a long haul lockdown, I stopped singing for probably 3 months. I just couldn't do it. The kind of separation thing from this is your identity was very weird. I'm sure anybody who was singing, I've spoken to people who sing barbershop or sing other things, even if they're not professional, it does feel like something was taken away. And the part of you that you used to express yourself with was taken away. And yeah, it was very odd, a very odd feeling. And then I started kind of saying, what can I do with my time after kind of sitting on the sofa for hours and watching Netflix? And I saw the collective had started, and so I joined as a music team member in about May, I think it must have been, maybe April, May. And it was wonderful. But in terms of the way COVID's affected my career is, we're still feeling the repercussions, even though I'm starting to work again. There's still things where you think, how can this company survive, or how can this orchestra keep going when they're paying people salaries and no income is coming in? And it really has, it's shown how little support there is for the arts in general, and not just singing, but every other type of art. It's been difficult. Very difficult.
Yeah. So now everything is beginning to start up again, and you're working again now. How are professionals working with the remains of COVID? It's scary to think it's still out there. Hasn't quite gone away. How are the professionals coping, and what's being put into place?
Yeah, so the contracts that I've done so far have had slightly different ways of working. So one of the contracts I did in Germany, for example, so I kind of see it from different sides, where to even start rehearsing, I had to have a PCR test. That was before anything happened. And they were, that was when cases were particularly low, actually, in October last year. But whenever we went into the building, masks completely all the time. The only time we also rehearsed in masks, actually singing. And the only time we really stopped using them was as soon as we were performing on stage. And as soon as you went off stage, the mask went back on. So in terms of that, the mask etiquette was really good.
Yeah.
We also would have the distancing, and that's been changed throughout the pandemic, throughout the time that we're in now. So we used to have a thing, well, in Germany we had that we couldn't sing next to each other facing out within 3 meters. And if we were singing directly at somebody, it was 6 meters away. Now in the UK, that has now changed to 2 meters face-to-face. And actually, there's been a lot of research into the kind of the amount of air that is expelled and the droplet risk, but also with the new variant, it's also very different, and it's just very difficult. A lot of companies are now testing regularly and rehearsing in masks without distancing, which also is very interesting, because as a singer, you if you do get it, unfortunately, you don't know how it will affect you. You don't know what the long-term effects are in terms of, we need our lungs for making our living. And you don't know how it affects every other part of you. And that's the thing that's quite scary with it. Another companies have been lateral flow testing every day and then PCR testing twice a week. So, and that's an added expense for companies. And they're not, they're not cheap. The PCR tests especially aren't. You just have to weigh up what your risks are and whether it's kind of worth it. And yeah, it's difficult. But also, I'd hope our colleagues would also try and keep each other safe. And sometimes you kind of hear people going out and when there are rules for sitting next to somebody in the pub, and which are very different from singing, you can't, it's hard to weigh up those and kind of get your head straight about that. But yeah, there are things in place, and touch wood, it's all been good so far. So yeah, I don't think there's been many examples of COVID spreading around big casts, which is great to know, and positive for the theatre industry especially.
Yeah, absolutely. It sounds like there's a lot of trust put in colleagues.
Yes. Yeah, and sometimes well, you think, please don't do that. Yeah. Can we, yeah, we look after each other. Or I mean, in my idea is to have a proper bubble where you just, then you're that bubble for the time that you're rehearsing, which would make a lot more sense. But then there's obviously other things and family members and all this kind of stuff. So yeah, it's not always possible.
No, no. It sounds like you're all doing your best though.
Yes, yeah.
Excellent, excellent. So earlier this year, you were rather, you were given rather short notice to, and called in to take part in the Cardiff Singer of the World
concert. Yes.
How did that happen? And what did that feel like? Because that was kind of still in the midst of it all, wasn't it? The COVID stuff.
Yeah. So so every 2 years there's this big competition, which is Cardiff Singer of the World, which seems quite grand. But and it is an amazing opportunity. And this year they didn't want to stop, didn't want COVID to stop it happening. So there were different ways that we didn't actually ever audition live. It was all done on video, which is, again, difficult depending on, you know, how much money you have to create a good video, or how you come over on a video compared to live, and with the way that sound frequencies work, some voices work better recorded, some don't. And so I applied. Well, actually, my partner pushed me into applying, which was very, I'm very grateful for.
Yeah, absolutely.
And in January, I was told that I was official reserve for it, which I'm very grateful for, and it was a great opportunity. But it also meant that I didn't know whether I would be asked to go on. I had to prepare all the music or give music at that point. And when it finally started that they were going to do it, and they were, the whole competition was without audience, and but would still be relayed internationally on stream and on the TV, on BBC. And it started, and I started watching it, and I hadn't been told officially that I was off the hook, but I presumed. And they started the rounds on the Saturday, so I watched a couple of them online, and I thought, this is really great. I'm really pleased with people. I had a lot of friends who were in it as well. And then on, the Tuesday, I had a phone call, a missed call, when I was in my garden. And I just thought, this is really weird. Why are they ringing me? And it was from a Welsh number. And so I rang up and rang back up. And they said, there's a possibility that we may need you to come to Cardiff as a reserve, because somebody has been told that somebody on their flight was positive for COVID, even though that she'd tested negative on PCRs that they'd already put in place. But because of the rules, especially in Wales at that time, they said, no, you need to isolate for 10 days. But they were trying to find different ways around it. So they said, can you get a car and come to Wales on Tuesday night? We don't know what's going to happen, but at least you're there. And we'll see what happens on the Wednesday morning, because you would have to go on Wednesday night. And still they had no news on Wednesday morning. They were trying to find if they could get very high specified PCR test or some way of letting this singer compete. And they still didn't know by 12 o'clock. And they just said, we can't wait any longer because we need to rehearse with the orchestra. Because it's on TV, we need to make sure that it does the hour and a half that it does. They can't just not have somebody.
Yeah.
And they said, yep, you're going to go on. So I had one dress. I had, they took, and they said, I think it was part of the dress I had was being held up by a pin because it was too booby. So I just, so they were like, do you want us to do something with this? Or, and then they're going to sort it all out. And I had half an hour's rehearsal with the orchestra. Didn't even run everything. We just did corners of bits. And then that night, I went on, and I thought, I'm just going to really enjoy this opportunity. I get to sing music that I love in a great auditorium as well. The St David's Hall is amazing. And I had no expectation whatsoever of winning that round. I just thought, this is great. But my name was announced as the winner, and that I'd be singing in the final in 2 days' time. And it was kind of, I think the if you've seen it, the reaction to it since I've seen it was like, oh yeah, I really did not know what was happening. And then we had a bit more rehearsal with the orchestra for Friday. But then being voted for by the general public to win the audience prize was, I don't know, yeah, amazing. And for anybody that did vote, thank you so, so, so much. Because it meant so much.
It was so amazing to watch, and I know a lot of collective members were voting and online and making comments, and it was amazing to watch you. It was a great journey.
Thank you. It was
so last minute.
Yeah, and I think that was kind of, for me, the best thing. My career up to that point actually had been a lot of last minute stuff, and weirdly I'm people say, you know, you don't seem fazed by it, and I don't know why. I just kind of then go with it. I think if I've got too much time to think about things, sometimes you can get into your head too much, and I kind of now try and take the idea that it is a last minute thing, even if it's not, to then make sure that things kind of stay calm, which just kind of doesn't make sense to a lot of people. But
I get that completely. So is that like a general way that you cope with your nerves
now? Yes, I mean, I do a lot of visualization. For me, that is kind of the easiest way for me to get into the zone that I'm doing. I can visualize the entire performance beforehand. And I always, as soon as I walk on stage, already visualize me walking off and knowing and thinking that I've just done a good performance, or thinking that I've done my best before I even do it, so that I've already got that end goal in mind. And usually that's the best way of me working with nerves. Usually if there's the phrase of kind of, if you're prepared enough, you've got nothing to be nervous about. And that's easier said than done, because you kind of, it's usually because you're overthinking, what is that person thinking, or am I going to be judged by this or that? But actually, if you think of the other mindset of, I am sharing this music with somebody else, and they're not out to get you, they sit there, especially an audience member that's paid, they want to enjoy the performance. It's not like you're, you know, they're being chained to the seat and they have to do it. They really want to enjoy what they're seeing, because they've either paid for it or are taking their time to go and see you or see the music that is performed, and that you're also a vehicle for that sound or for that performance or that composer's writing or that arranger's way of putting this across, or the lyricist, everything put into one. So I try and not think too grand, and that way it kind of keeps you centered.
Yeah, what great advice. That's fab. That's fab. How long do you visualize before your event?
I build it up, so as soon as I know all my music and have rehearsed it, I will probably do it the night before a concert, before I wake up, when I wake up, while I'm standing on stage. And the more you do it, the quicker it becomes. So you don't need to visualize every single bit. So if you do the whole thing, it's kind of similar to memory palace work as well. At the same time, I was watching this amazing kind of, it's not really a documentary, but it was a thing on Channel 4 that Sandy Toksvig was doing about memory work. I would highly recommend everybody watching it. But it also means that, like, the more you do a longer bit of visualization, the easier it is then to kind of break it up into smaller key points, and then you link it all together because you've already done it. And there's this thing that you never...
When you say key points, do you mean kind of tricky bits in the song?
Yeah, so tricky bits. So if you think of a song and think, I'm scared of for me, like, scared of a high note or whatever, the more I realize that actually once I finish that note, it's going to be fine, the easier then that becomes, or the tricky bit of passage work or not knowing where I'm going to place that vocally in my range. The more I do it right, the easier, not only does it become physically easier because your muscle memory works, it also just, you don't get as scared about it. And then it's usually better anyway, because you're not creating any tension. So yeah, the more you can do that, the easier it all becomes. And I'm a big fan of visualization and also just actually walking things and using every skill that you can think of in your rehearsal to help you with that performance. And but then also once you're out there, not thinking if something is different from your visualization pattern that that's wrong. Like once you're there, know that you've done that work and then let yourself go, because that's all been done before. And that way you can take risks, and but they're risks within a box rather than kind of going, oh, I don't know if that's going to work or not.
Yeah, brilliant.
Great.
So is your favourite piece of music to sing? So what is it? And is it a challenging piece for you? Or is it an easy piece for you? What do you go for? What gives you the thrills? Is it the hard stuff that kind of you have to do all the visualisation for? Or something that you can just lay back and, well, not lay back, sit back and do?
I'm not sure I can ever specify a piece on its own. I think there's so many elements that go with that. For me, I have composers that I love singing, and that's usually due to the way that the composer either sets the words or the way that it makes me, the music viscerally makes me feel. So for me, more Germanic composers really set that off. So kind of Richard Wagner or Richard Strauss or Mahler, and those kind of big symphonic works, things that are kind of, they're also the start of film music type things. So that when you think of watching a film and thinking, I'm being really moved by this. If you turn the sound off, you wouldn't really be moved by it, but the music really kind of connects to emotions. So for me, anything that I feel an emotional connection to is my favourite thing to do. I know a lot of other people would say I really like doing lots of runny stuff, or I really like doing stuff with loads of loud high notes. But for me, that's not. It's really how that composer makes the best use of the text and the way of that emotional storyline.
Okay, so if you were able to just pluck a role and a place to sing it in,
okay,
what would be your role and your perfect place to perform it? Or you might have done it.
Not yet. So at the moment, I'm in Edinburgh, singing at the Edinburgh International Festival, and I'm singing there's only two mezzo roles in the entire piece, and I'm singing the small one. The other one is quite high and is amazing, but not really me yet. But if I could have like fantasy role, because it wouldn't be a role that I might sing yet, would be Ariadne in Richard Strauss's Ariadne, which is what we're doing at the moment, because the way that he uses the lines, the amount of emotional connection is amazing. And I'd love to do that at, like, I don't know, Fantasyland, the Metropolitan Opera. I mean, that would be like amazing, but there's a lot of hoops and stuff to go through there, if that ever
happens. There's a plug there. Fantastic. Oh, Claire, it's been amazing chatting to you.
Thank you.
Huge congratulations on your audience award. It was so moving to watch. And I think we were just as moved by your reactions to the results as to the pieces. It was incredible. It was incredible. And certainly Facebook was mad throughout your performances. It was just going mad. So it was great, and I know our collective members are just going to be thrilled to have seen you again. Have you got anything that you would like to share, any last bits?
I just say make sure you keep singing and find things that really connect with you, and it's such a communicative way of relating to people, to audiences, and things will be better soon and we'll be able to sing together. But with things like the collective and other ways of being able to connect, it is amazing. And kind of keep going with that. Make sure you breathe properly, and make sure you're using those lower abdominal muscles. Diaphragm is not is an involuntary muscle, I will keep saying. And just don't sing with tension. If it doesn't feel right, it's probably not. So find the easiest way of singing, and just keep singing and having fun. And keep coming to performances when you feel safe enough, because the arts industry and theatre industry needs everybody behind it. So if you can, and or other place too, then please do come. Please do come and watch things.
We will, we will. Claire, thank you so much.
And oh, thank you.
We do pop in to a rehearsal when you have a moment. Pop in, come and say hi. Be lovely to see you. Great. A welcome. But for now, we'd like to wish you luck in Milan next week.
Rome.
Yeah. Right. Have fun in Rome.
Thank you. Thanks so much.
Bye. See you soon. Bye.
Bye. So the production that I'm in at the moment at the Edinburgh International Festival is being streamed live, and will also be available for 6 months. And that will be available from now, I suppose. And will be, I'll send the link over, but it's a really good piece. It's kind of fun. And there'll be surtitles. It's in German, but also gives the surtitles in English. It's a good piece to listen to.
Excellent. We'll look forward to looking at it.
Great.
Thank you.
Crazy now, running wild with laughter. swarming down in parachutes a thousand strong. Everything now is cleared up and wonderful. Everyone is happy as pie, and they all do a great rumba version of Mad Men, of course. It's a dazzling sight. With the sleek brown native women dancing with the U.S. Navy boys and a 100-piece symphony orchestra. If I don't get going this minute, there won't be any dinner when Sam comes home!